thanks very much, Julie, and thanks everyone for coming. We have a lot to get through, so I will jump right into it. And I will try to, as much as possible, since we're taping this for future use. Those of you who have been classical, I like to pace up and down, so I'm going to try to chain myself as much as possible to the podium so that Brian can capture this on film and also capture the audio. When Julie asked me to consider doing an exhibition that features the Vincenziana collections at the university, I knew immediately what the topic of that exhibition would be. I've been fascinated over the years, in more than 30 years that I've been studying Vincent de Paul, from the perspective of how Vincent de Paul has been publicly presented to the world, how Vincent de Paul has been publicly presented to Catholicism, how Vincent de Paul has been publicly presented over four centuries across the continents, across the human experience. And there is, as I've studied that representation of Vincent de Paul the person and Vincent de Paul the saint, there is a great divide that immediately becomes apparent to anyone who even does a cursory study of the iconography of Vincent de Paul over those four centuries. And that seismic shift in iconography, which we're going to describe at some length in this talk, is really a concept of rebranding. When Vincent de Paul was originally canonized by the Roman Catholic Church, and for the remainder of the Ansgar regime, until the great seismic shifts supported by the French Revolution, there was a particular brand, if you will, a particular way that Vincent de Paul was always expressed iconographically. After the deluge of the French Revolution, after the deluge and the tremendous tumult of this seismic shift, certainly in Western civilization, Vincent de Paul emerged from that and was rebranded in a very, very different way than he had previously been branded. And this rebranded Vincent de Paul is the Vincent de Paul that you and I are most familiar with. What I'm going to suggest in my talk is that I want to describe this use of original branding, this rebranding for modernity, if you will, but in the end I'm going to talk about what I believe is the rebranding for post-modernity of Vincent de Paul that is taking place as we speak. So essentially this is a case study in the historical rebranding of a saint, and our saint. Let me just talk about what rebranding is from this perspective. It's a major identifiable change in brand positioning. And what do we mean by a brand? A brand is nothing more than a public promise. Think of Kellogg's. If you think of Kellogg's, Kellogg's has made us as consumers a public promise about what it will deliver to us in terms of breakfast foods. McDonald's brand is a public promise to us to deliver what they deliver. This is not about quality. Amazon has a brand. Sears has a brand. So this whole question of branding is not just about business, it's also about other aspects of human experience, and it's also about sanctity. So it's a major identifiable change in brand positioning and aesthetics in response to changing market conditions that fundamentally redefines a product or a company, or in our case, a saint. So again, this is the rebranding of a saint. This is the rebranding of Saint Vincent de Paul. And this rebranding is absolutely necessary, because if you don't shift to meet new market conditions, if you don't shift to meet new market demands, you go out of business. Okay? A la Sears, and no, anytime now we're going to be open up the pages and there'll be no more Sears. So part of this is this rebrand, you need to rebrand, which means you have to reinvent yourself. And you then rebrand your reinvention. And if you do that and do that successfully, you survive. If you don't do that successfully, obsolescence and your brand disappears from the marketplace. I want to again talk about, because my premise is that the rebranding of Vincent de Paul that took place during the 19th century was essentially a romantic rebranding. It emerged from romanticism. So I like to again define my terms. This is how I understand romanticism in the context of rebranding that I'm going to be talking about. From this perspective, romanticism is an aesthetic and interpretive movement, predominant especially in the first half of the 19th century. I would characterize it as an escapist movement, which appeals always to the heart rather than to the mind, always to emotion rather than to rationality, always to feeling rather than to sensibility. And in service of this romantic vision, history is to be molded and, if needed, distorted to serve the perceived highest truth and aim. So that's how I'm working with Romanticism. Now, what you also understand is this rebranding of Vincent de Paul in the 19th century was a French enterprise. And so it emerges not just from Romanticism, but it emerges from Romanticism cast from the perspective of French exceptionalism. Now, we're all familiar in our recent political and ongoing political debates, this whole idea of American exceptionalism, that dating back to Manifest Destiny, that, you know, the political rhetoric around American exceptionalism is that, you know, America is the shining beacon on the hill, et cetera, that there's a manifest destiny for America to be, make America great again. So, you know, we're in the midst of this rethinking and this representation with all of its consequences, both negative, very negative, and positive, about American exceptionalism. Well, there's nothing new about American exceptionalism, because in Western civilization, in the history of Western civilization, American exceptionalism was preceded by British exceptionalism. The sun never sets on the British Empire until it set. And if you will, British exceptionalism was preceded and in some respects accompanied by French exceptionalism. And in particular, the 19th century French exceptionalism, dating back, it's not just a post-revolutionary expression, but it's also pre-revolutionary exceptionalism. You know, the whole exceptionalism of Louis XIV's France. France as the predominant experience, the predominant cultural definer, the predominant political definer, the predominant definer of European civilization, which dates, you know, again, this isn't just something that Napoleon and the French in the 19th century invented. This goes back to the Bourbons under the Ancien Régime. So this, again, this romanticism, this French romanticism, is based on the French self-identity of French exceptionalism. The manifest destiny, again, this is put in exactly the same terms. We think about the terms in which American exceptionalism is being expressed in our experience. Those exact terms with those exact same consequences were happening in the 19th century with the French claim to exceptionalism. Again, this idea of the manifest destiny of the distinctive genius of France to serve as a determinant of cultural, philosophical, political, religious, of course, religious meaning Catholic, an imperial force in the world, the standard by which everything in the world is judged, the standard by which everything in the world is to be compared to. Let's talk about the original branding. Vincent de Paul, the person, becomes Saint Vincent de Paul. As we know, Vincent de Paul died in Paris on September 27, 1660. And as we know, that at the time that he died, he was immediately, at that time, perceived, the public perception of Vincent Paul was this man who had just died, this famous man who had just died. A common consensus was this man whom we, again speaking of the people surrounding him, this man whom we heard with our own ears, this man whom we saw with our own eyes, this man who has now passed from the scene in front of us, this man was a saint. This man lived a life of heroic sanctity. This man lived a life of heroic discipleship as a disciple of Jesus Christ. And this heroicity is equivalent to sanctity. And one day, of course, the belief was in 1660, that one day the church would recognize the heroicity of this sanctity with canonization. So the whole process by which Vincent, from the first eulogy, of course, given by the Mont Tour in November of 1660, which really kicks off the official or the unofficial canonization process. So you think of that November 23rd, 1660 as being the kickoff of this canonization campaign. That campaign concludes on June 16, 1737, when Vincent de Paul was canonized by Clement XIV. And here we have a copy to the right here. This is a published copy of the Bull of Canonization, which of course we have in our special collections. What we have to the left is what is believed to be the only contemporary portrait of Vincent de Paul painted in life. Now again, as we know, Vincent de Paul, during his lifetime, would never allow his portrait to be officially painted. And this is in contrast because in that era, if you were anybody, the sign that you were somebody was to have your portrait painted. And the more important you were, the more important artist that you commissioned to do that portrait. And so, you know, there'd be kind of a hierarchy of importance and a hierarchy of painters. And all of the figures of church, all the figures of state, all the figures of nobility, one of the ways that you signaled who you were, that you signaled your importance, and the way in which that importance was acknowledged by the people around you was through an official portrait. And what we know is that Vincent de Paul would never allow that portrait to be done. And he would never allow that portrait to be done, as we know, because he steadfastly refused the cult of personality. He steadfastly refused that attention, because any time anyone tried to pay that attention to him personally and try to turn it into celebrity or try to turn it into, again, this cult of personality, he would immediately turn that away and say, it's not about me, it's about the mission. It's not about me, it's about the poor. It's not about me, it's about how we serve. And so, but what we do have, again, is this life portrait of Vincent, done certainly near the end of his life. As you can see, he's rather grizzled and gray around the edges. If you look very, very closely, you can see that there are teeth missing. And this portrait, of course, is preserved at the Vincentian Museum of the Mother House in Paris. And many of us have seen it, and some of us will see it in about a week or so. So that's the idea that this the portraiture of Vincent de Paul. And this portraiture, so if we think about all the eras of Vincent's branding and rebranding, there is a consistent portraiture of Vincent de Paul, which is reflective of the kind of visage that you see, though it's an old Vincent de Paul. Again, if you were to look through, for example, Father Reibold's online image archive of over 19,000 images, the vast majority of those images, you look at that, and you, without paying attention to anything else, you immediately recognize the facial features of Vincent de Paul. So in all of these eras, you have the consistent portraiture of Vincent de Paul, where you have, you know, a figure of his head, a figure of his face, or a bust of him, you know, or sometimes in a holy card. So you'll see the portraiture. So that is consistent throughout all the branding and rebranding of Vincent de Paul. What changes is the active positioning of Vincent de Paul, because a portrait just invites you into the person. The other images of Vincent de Paul invite you beyond the person into his sanctity and into what made him a saint. And so we're going to see that we have this substratum that continues throughout this of the portraiture of Vincent de Paul. Now, previous to the French Revolution, the absolutely predominant expression, iconographic expression of Vincent de Paul outside of portraiture is as Vincent the Evangelizer. Because remember, in his primary identity in pre-revolutionary France, the reason for which he was canonized by the church in 1737 is not as the Vincent of England. He was canonized essentially for being the most, one of the most effective evangelizers of the Catholic Reformation. All right. So this is the prototypical, if I were to choose one image that expresses all the iconography of Vincent de Paul, all the active iconography over portraiture of Vincent de Paul, from his canonization in 1737 until the French Revolution, I would choose this engraving. And this engraving, of course, is based on the statue of Vincent de Paul, which is, and has been since 1754, displayed in St. Peter's in Rome by this Italian royal sculptor, Pietro Bracci. And it's been in St. Peter's in Rome since 1754. So again, think of this as, and this is Vincent the Evangelizer. You know, there's no doubt about it. You know, he's got the crucifix, and he has a stance of preaching. And at his feet are the open book of the gospel. So again, this whole idea, what is he preaching? He's preaching the word of the gospel. What is he preaching? He's preaching about Jesus crucified, and he's doing this in an active sort of way. So again, this is the predominant image that captures Vincent de Paul for the Catholic world and for the world before the French Revolution. But we begin to see, again, here, under the Ancien Régime, Vincent de Paul was branded as the successful church reformer and the evangelizer. And so all of this pre-revolutionary iconography is swept away by the French Revolution. Because it's what the French Revolution sweeps away the Ancien Regime. It sweeps away the political landscape. It sweeps away the cultural landscape. It sweeps away the religious landscape. And after the revolutionary period, as the 19th century emerges, a new world has to be built. And this new world that emerges is a very, very vibrant, very, very tumultuous world. It's the age of revolutions. If you think about the 19th century, it's the age of political revolution. It's the age of cultural revolution. It's the age of economic revolution. It's the age of religious revolution. It's the age of technological revolution. And it introduces a new paradigm for Western civilization, replacing that which historians now call the Ancien Regime, replacing with what historians would now call modernity. Right. So think of modernity, think of post-French Revolution and everything that the 19th century introduces. And so the Vincentians of this era, the Vincentians of the 19th century, who had barely survived the collapse of the Ancien Regime, these Vincentians had to rebrand themselves to find a claim and a place in this new world. And in order to rebrand themselves, they had to rebrand Vincent de Paul. Right? So this is what is at stake for this rebranding. And the leaders of this rebranding, the leaders of this 19th century French romantic rebranding of Vincent de Paul, are the Lazarists themselves. But remember that what really gives the brand of Vincent de Paul is immediately indicated by this inescapable adjective saint. And that brand doesn't change. Right? Because what the Roman Catholic Church has said about that word and the brand that it represents, has said, is saying now, will always say, so essentially what does it mean when the Roman Catholic Church, through its various processes which have changed over time, what does it mean when the Roman Catholic Church assigns this adjective to a historical person, a historical man, or a historical woman? What the Church is officially saying is that we, as the Catholic Church, after having exhaustively studied the life of this person, after having exhaustively studied the historicity of this person, studied and questioned and challenged that life story, we have come to the conclusion, and that conclusion has been confirmed by miracles, we have come to the conclusion that this man or this woman can be seen as an infallible guide to any Christian of any era on how to lead the life of an authentic disciple of Christ. So, Saint Vincent, Saint Louis de Marillac. What the Church is saying, because we have judged them worthy and because we have given them this adjective, you, as a disciple of Christ, can use their life, can use their words, can use their faith, can use everything about them as a model for how you choose to form your own discipleship. Okay? So this is once the Catholic Church gives that brand, that's the kind of eternal brand. So it's the proverbial halo effect. Because again, if you look at Vincent before canonization, no halo. But after his beatification in 1729, from 1729 after 1737, you see Vinny, and then you have that brand statement right there. It's the equivalent of the golden arches. Now, this is another expression of the typical, prototypical branding of Vincent de Paul in the Ancien Regime. And these are the sculptures, the original sculpture by Bracci, that is presently on display. It has been on display since 1754 on the main floor of St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. And here's its exact location. It's on the right side. As you enter St. Peter's, it's on the right side. And you can see Vinny here. This is the statue here. And this is the Blessed Sacrament Chapel. So it's a very, very prominent position. And so it took from the completion of the basilica around 1621 until 1947 to fill all those interior niches. Okay. As a matter of fact, a little historical factoid on the side, the last interior statue that was put in place in 1947 was Louis de Marillac. Okay. So we have, it's not hard to tell you where it's at, but it's just there. Now we get to the 19th century. Jean-Baptiste Etienne. Jean-Baptiste Etienne was the 14th successor of Vincent de Paul. He enters the community. He's born, he lives from 1801 to 1874. He lives at the height of French Romanticism. He lives at the height of French exceptionalism. And he translates that Romanticism, and he translates that exceptionalism into the Vincentian ethos. And he is essentially, not to say that he's personally responsible for the refoundation of the Vincentian tradition, what you have to say, he becomes the symbol for the successful refoundation of the Vincentian tradition in the 19th century world. It would not have been possible without his distinctive personality, without his distinctive genius, without his distinctive brilliance, and also without his distinctive and very obvious faults. Etienne was fond of saying, when comparing himself to Saint Vincent, Saint Vincent was a saint, and I certainly am not a saint, and none of his contemporaries ever argued with that statement. But he was, from 1843 until 1874, the effective head of the Vincentian tradition, the Vincentian family in the world, and it's really, he is irreplaceable in this refoundation and in this reformulation. And we're going to kind of look at then, from this perspective, how Etienne, on behalf of the Vincentian tradition, undertakes this rebranding. And so on April 24th, 1864, Monsieur Etienne presided over the dedication of a shrine complex that was built outside of docks in the southwest of France. It's Saint Vincent's birthplace. In French, the word for cradle is the berceau. So the title of the shrine is Le Berceau. And so this was a dedication of Vincent's birthplace shrine. And this is a key quote from what Etienne had to say in his speech on this day. Divine Providence destined Saint Vincent de Paul to be a person to speak to his own times. He is also a person called to speak to the present century. He will also be a person called to speak to future centuries. He deserves to be recognized as the restorer of religion. He deserves to be recognized as the apostle of charity. He deserves to be recognized as the savior of the homeland, la patrie. He deserves to be recognized as the apostle of modern times. And so we find in this one quotation from Mr. Etienne, the essential rebranding of Vincent de Paul for the 19th century. Vincent de Paul rebranded as the apostle of modern times and as the apostle of charity by a rather tubby Baptiste Etienne. Now, this rebranding had roots, right? Just doesn't emerge from somewhere, from nowhere. And this rebranding emerges, as a matter of fact, because there are never these very, very sharp divisions before and after. There's always this kind of back and forth as an era just doesn't cleanly end and a new era begins. There's always some kind of winding down at the same time there's some winding up. And so the winding down of the old brand of Vincent de Paul and the winding up of the new brand of Vincent de Paul, in contrast to this, I say this is roots in the era right before the French Revolution. And as Simone Zurowski has brilliantly shown in her research, the first identifiable depiction of Vincent de Paul, not as the evangelizer, not as the church reformer, but as the apostle of charity, as the apostle of modern times, is this statue by Jean-Baptiste Stuc, and his dates were 1742 to 1826. On the left, you have a maquette for this statue, which is now at Minneapolis, is this one. And you can see, and actually, I prefer the maquette. I wish the final statue was closer to the maquette. And here is the final statue. This is a copy that's presently in the Church of St. Thomas Aquinas in Paris. And what's interesting about the final copy, and so this is the first time is Vincent with babies. Before this, there's not a single example of Vincent de Paul with babies. After this, in particular, once you get rebranded, you almost never see the previous one. And remember, as I said, if one baby is good, two babies is better, three babies, four babies, the more the merrier. And of course, what's interesting is that this statue was commissioned by Louis XVI himself. Right? Because Louis XVI wanted to create this pantheon of the great figures of France, and he knew immediately that the religious figure that he wanted in that pantheon was Vincent de Paul. So this kind of 19th century iconographic image of Vincent de Paul, rebranded as the Apostle of Charity, rebranded as the Apostle of Modern Times, actually emerges during the Ensemble regime under the ill-fated Louis XVI. Now, what's kind of hard to see in this statue is that, and what you see here, of course, is Vincent is holding one abandoned child, and there's another abandoned child at his feet. But when you actually see the statue in real life, it looks like he's dropped the baby. and I always call it the oops statue. Which is, oh, I got people up and you don't hold it on me. So this is the image that emerges. Now, from that theme, and you can immediately, I think, see the resemblances. How, if this is the root of all subsequent iconography of Vincent de Paul, of Vincent de Paul the Apostle of Charity, for me, this is the most important single non-sculptural representation of that image. And this is a very, very famous, it started out as a painting. This is an engraving. I believe the original painting is lost. But we have many, many engravings of it. And this is, and the artist was Nicolas André Monceau, again, this date 1754 to 1857. And this painting, the original painting, was exhibited in the 1817 Paris Salon. As you know, in the 19th century and in that era, the Paris Salon was the place for an artist. If you got into the Paris Salon, if you won one of the prizes in the Paris Salon, that set your career. Right. And 1817 is the beginning of the Restoration period, the restoration of the Bourbon monarchy after the Napoleon interregnum. And in that period of the Restoration, salons, especially under Louis XVIII, especially under Charles X, there were many of these iconic images of this Paul that emerge. And you know, again, to be in the Paris Salon means the highest level of artists, the highest level of artistic engraving. And so this really, again, and we have this engraving in our collection, and it's, in, of course, is in the exhibition. But what I'd like to point out, I'd like to just take a minute to look at and to dissect the iconography. Because a portrait, if you look at a very, very skilled portrait, you can really, and if it's well done, a good portrait draws you in to contemplate the person being portrayed. Same thing with a sculpture. Yet there are limits to that. And a painting or an engraving painting like that, you're able to tell a much more detailed, much more layered story. And that's exactly what this painting, this engraving does. And so, for example, if you look, and the legend, if you will, at the bottom of the painting, translated from the French, is Saint Vincent de Paul, founder of the Ladies of Charity and the Orphans Hospice, saving infants from the rigors of winter after they have been abandoned by their mothers. Okay? So again, if we look very, very carefully at this, and remember if you think about Romanticism in literature, the pun about how every romantic novel would begin would be, it was a dark and stormy night. It's a dark and stormy night. And if you want to add pathos, if you want to add drama, it's not just a dark and stormy night, but it's a cold, snowy, dark, and stormy night. But those of you who know anything about climate in Paris know that, on average, measurable snowfall in Paris that stays on the ground might be once in every 25 years. There's never a time where you walk through the snow-covered streets of Paris. But right here, dark and stormy night, snow-covered streets of Paris. And again, cold, dark, stormy, winter. So you have all these layers of pathos, all these layers of feeling, all these layers of romanticism. And remember, one of the ideas, and this is very true, during the original 15th century experience, one of the primordial charitable activities was the rescue of abandoned children. And we know that the scale of abandoned children exploded exponentially during Vincent Louis's lifetime because of economic conditions, because of war conditions, because of famine, etc., etc. And we know that Vincent and Louise and the original conqueror's daughters found ways to effectively care for all those children. But as a matter of fact, you know, Vincent never walked through the streets of Paris picking up babies. Never. But once you portray them this way. And so you tell, this is a very, tells a very, very complex story. So what you see then, in at the beginning of the story, so imagine Vincent, he has come around the corner in the background. He already has one, his one child in his hand. And the implication is that, you know, if you're walking, carrying a child, you hold it, you cradle the child in both arms. What happens if you come around the corner and you suddenly see another child? Well, you immediately have to shift the child that you are cradling into one arm to free the other arm to enable you to reach down and pick up this child. We capture the perhaps the anatomical dynamism of this figure exactly at that moment where Vincent, having shifted the weight of the child to one arm, is reaching out, and you can just see his knees beginning to bend so that he can kneel down into the snow, sweep up the other child, and have the other child in his arms as well. Now, and of course, what we have here is the presumption is that this is the mother who has abandoned this child. And she has abandoned this child not just to chance. She, from this position, would have seen Vincent coming. She would have seen that Vincent already had a child in her arms, and she would have seen that Vincent was going to turn the corner. So where does she purposely leave her child? Exactly where he will be found by Vincent. All right. Now, the way you can tell the story is you have to pay attention to the footprints. If you count those footprints, there are more footprints leading up to that baby than just Vincent's. And in fact, there are two sets of footprints. There are the first set of footprints are those of the mother who has gone ahead of Vincent, knowing where he's going to come. She has left her baby, and she's just left her baby momentarily, because you can see in the midst of this cold, in the midst of the snow, the child is, even though it has a blanket, is laying there exposed. And so the whole point was that the mother would not leave the child exposed if she didn't know he, again, I'm assuming it's he, would be immediately picked up. All right, and you leave the child unbound so that to make sure that Vincent would see, because the child is, again, because you can see the child is kind of struggling, et cetera, et cetera. And so the woman, having deposited her child, knowing that Vincent was coming, the woman has retreated. Now that she sees that the child is going to be rescued, she prepares to exit, stage left. All right. So again, you see all the layers that this, that a representation like this, it adds all the drama, it adds all the pathos, it adds everything that really, you know, again, this is not an appeal to rationality. This is not an appeal to where are we going to get to pay the money to pay for all this. This is a rationale. This is an appeal to the emotiveness of you see a baby and you don't ask any questions. You pick that baby up and you care for him or her. Now, so again, if we look at this, again, I consider this, as I've said, to be the primordial example of this representation from now to, from then until the present. In our exhibition, which you can see downstairs, you can see how this theme is immediately picked up and repeated in various forms represented in the collection. Here we have a several-like vase, very, very classical. This is a classical representation, a classical urn. And what would happen is, this is not a Sèvres, which is the most famous porcelain maker, but it's a Sèvres, a high-quality Sèvres knockoff, if you will. And what they do is, again, this is a period, I would date this to the first half of the 19th century, because once you get past the first half of the 19th century, classicalism goes out, and everything's very baroquish and very, you know, flamboyant. And whereas this is still a very, very classical urn. And what they do is they would produce the urn, and then you could have whatever kind of picture you wanted painted there. Now, this isn't just a cheap transfer ware, this is hand-painted. So this is a hand-painted copy of the Monceau portrait. What we have here is 1827 clock, which again, it repeats the same scene from there. So again, what you have to remember about the 19th century, this is for the first time, because of the Industrial Revolution, you now have a middle class with disposable income. And how do you, if you're a bourgeois family with disposable income, how do you demonstrate to everybody that you arrived? Well, one of the things you do in a bourgeois French household is to have a mantel clock. And if you're a religious family, then you say, we're going to have a minute, or a religious mantel clock. And if Vincent's a girl, you guess, so you're bourgeois, you're religious, you're Catholic, and you want to identify Vincent. And so the fact that these items were produced means that there's a market for them. There's a market for them, means people want them. People are willing to spend, in these cases, a lot of money. another very, very high-end 19th century cast bronze grouping of which clearly gets its inspiration from the painting. This is also in the exhibition. Now we're going to get out of these, the cards I'm about to show you are not in the exhibition. They're in our Vincenziana collection. When I originally started thinking about doing the exhibition, Julie showed me the space, and I said, well, how many objects do you estimate we can put in the space? And I had already gone through and I had 75. She said 25. We ended up with 31. Okay. But that 31 comes from 10,000. So we have 10,000 items in our collection. And so what those 71 items do is to illustrate all of the major themes. And so so these are holy cards of Vincent de Paul that are in the collection but not in the exhibition, but just in a random look through a couple pages of those digitized items, you can clearly see, once again, this is yet another version of the Mons. So street scene, one baby in the arm, a baby on the, of course, there's no mother here, but so you can immediately see the various details which are repeated or not repeated, but the core representation is exactly what is in the painting. Three more. Three more. Some are exact copies, as you can see. Others are inspired, or, you know, but in some way, you immediately see that you can see exactly what their artistic roots come, where they come from. So what I'd like to talk about is this kind of switch. The rebranding of Vincent de Paul required the rebranding of his life story, right, from beginning to end. And this is, again, part of the distinctive genius of Mr. Etienne. Not just the rebranding of Vincent de Paul, but the rebranding of his life story. And he does this, again, you rebrand Vincent from his birth to his death. And so this takes place during this entire period. Mr. Etienne enters the Vincentians in 1880. And he's one of the first Vincentians to enter after the Revolution. So from the very, very beginning, because he's talented, because he's smart, because he's a political climber, and he is, he immediately comes into positions of, and he never leaves positions of authority. So he is a key element, even when he's not the leader of this restoration, he is influenced by it and is influencing it as it emerges. And so as this finally emerges, and I'm going to date this from the beginning, the Vincentians go to take possession of Rudisev, the new mother house of Rudisev, on November 1st, 1818. So I'm really dating what I'm talking about now from 1818 until 1864. What we have here, if you look to the left, in 1864, as I said, Jean-Baptiste Etienne opened a shrine complex outside of docks in the southwest of France. And what was interesting about this rebranding of Vincent de Paul, he told this story very, very carefully. There's no element of this rebranding of Vincent de Paul and rebranding of the story that is absent. So we begin with a reconstruct a la Disney. So think of the castle at Disney World. So this is the Vincentian equivalent of the castle of Disney World, Vincent's birthplace. We know it was built on land that we know belonged to Vincent, but the original house wasn't extant, but there were some houses that were that old, so it's a little bit of this, but that, and you come up with Vincent's birthplace. What you also see here is the famous 800-year-old oak tree. Look at the presumption was, well, it's been here 800 years, so it would have been here where Vincent was here, and it was here where Vincent was here, then he probably prayed under it. So, and then, of course, a chapel. But what this the religious part is accompanied, is surrounded by an orphanage, is surrounded by an old folks' hospice, is surrounded by a minor seminary. So again, the message is that this saint that we're going to talk about, you can't understand him just by the place he was born, just by all this stuff. You understand by the fruits of the concrete fruits of what he's done. What we have here in, which is, this is in the exhibition, this is a very, very fine cast bronze done for the opening. And we know it was done for the opening because, although it's hard to see here, the date is April 24th, 1864. What I believe these to have been was, you don't build something like this without donors. So what I believe is that this is a high-end gift to donors who put enough zeros on the check. Okay. Again, very fine casting, solid bronze, and another element of this is that embedded in this, this is not just a portrait, but it has an embedded relic. And then this whole point, the relics of Vincent de Paul have played a key part in his sanctity from the moment he dies. And so when you rebrand again, Catholicism likes parts. And there's something powerful about the physicality. Modern sensibilities might find it a little bit, but it's part of the Roman Catholic physicality, materiality. And so to have a devotion to Vincent de Paul, which is expressed by a very, very high quality portraiture of him, let alone to have that accompanied by authenticated relics, okay, is again the level of this. So this is a very, very important rebranding piece. This is the chapel that Monsieur Etienne built. And again, this is the chapel. And we'll see more about the iconography. And here's the Disneyfied birthplace. Here's a beautiful photograph of the front of the chapel. And so it's hard to see the element, but I want to call you out. We're going to look at this element here in a minute. And we're also going to look at the statue of Vincent here in a minute. So, if you look at the tympanum over the front door, there is a quotation in Latin, quis putas per iste erit. And this is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verse 66. What then will this child become? So it is taking, in Luke, it's the question to Jesus, well, who will this child become? Etienne is taking it and applying it to this. This is Vincent's birthplace. Put yourself back. Vincent's being born here, and the question that you pose is, what then will this child become? And so this shrine asks that question, what then will this child become? At the same time it is answered, this child will become the apostle of modern times, this child will become the apostle of charity. So it asks the question and answers the question with the shrine. And so you have, and this is the very apocryphal account of Vincent as a young boy taking his allowance and sharing it with a poor person. Okay. And this is a statue of Vincent, which is at the summit of this pediment here. And this is, again, a very, very, so again, Vincent, this is a very, very important pose of Vincent. He is not holding a crucifix. He is not preaching. He's reaching out, welcoming. All right. So this is another major shift. And again, Etienne never uses that evangelizer image. It's always the apostle of charity, the apostle welcoming, inviting. And so again, the state, this is not by accident. This is not by accident, as you can see. And there he is again. So Monsieur Etienne rebranding Vincent de Paul and the Vincentians in the 19th century. So at the other end, remember, he has to rebrand Vincent's entire life. And so, what then will this child become? This child will become the apostle of charity. What does this child who becomes the apostle of charity, what does he do? And Etienne picks up yet another phrase from Scripture, from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10, verse 58, per transit bene facendo. Remember, this is St. Peter describing Jesus. He went about doing good. So, Vincent de Paul, the apostle of charity, what did he do as the apostle of charity? He went about doing good. So this is the other phrase that Etienne uses as a key rebranding element. And we'll see how he uses it very, very creatively. And he uses it in rebranding Vincent and rebranding Vincent's burial place and rebranding Vincent's shrine. This is the shrine of Vincent de Paul at its original location of Saint Lazare, Old Saint Lazare, which was the Vincentian mother house from January 12, 1632 until September 1, 1792. where Vincent was immediately buried. Remember, he died September 27, 1660. He was buried there September 28, 1660, and was there until the revolution. And so this is, on the left there, this is a depiction, and this is the Rue Saint-Denis, and this is a depiction of the original Gothic chapel, which was part of the complex where Vincent was buried, and this is a view of the shrine as it emerged after his beatification and canonization. So, and of course, this disappears with the revolution. The Saint-Lazare is confiscated, it is turned into a prison. I always like to say that, you know, the census were there one day, it's a prison the next. That tells you a little bit about the living conditions. And as a matter of fact, this is preserved, of course, until 19. The prison becomes a prison, then it becomes a revolutionary prison, then it becomes a women's prison. As a matter of fact, the fabric of this on the original footprint lasts until May of 1940. And because you can still visit Paris today and still see the original footprint. But it becomes a major pilgrimage shrine. It's one of the pilgrimage shrines of pre-revolutionary Paris. Because Vincent de Paul, again, is a French saint, is the French saint. And so when all this has disappeared, you have to recreate this. When Vincent is recreated, when Vincent is rebranded 19th century France, 19th century Paris, and this is all lost, you have to recreate this somehow. And this is how the Chartiennes and the Vincentians recreate this. Again, this is the old a view of the old pre-revolutionary Saint-Lazare. This is the very, very famous Turgot map. Here's the Rue Saint-Denis. And so the gate of Paris is right here. Remember, Vincent lived in the suburbs. And when Vincent would say, I'm going into town, he'd walk out the front door, take a right, walk for 20 minutes to be at Notre Dame. And so here's the original Saint-Lazare. This is what it looked like on July 13, 1789. Those of you who remember from your Western Civ class when your professor told you that the French Revolution began on July 14, 1789, the storming of Bastille, if you see that professor today, tell him he or she was wrong. That the precipitating event of the French Revolution was not the sacking of the Bastille on the 14th of July, but the sacking of Saint-Lazare the previous day. The first act of public revolutionary violence. So, this is the 19th century world that Monsieur Etienne, and I love these portraits, I have these portraits in. So if you think about Monsieur Etienne, 1801 to 1874, what that means is he lived through, I don't have Napoleon in the first here, but he lived through the First Empire. He lived through the reign of Louis XVIII and Charles X and the Bourbon Restoration. He lived through the July monarchy of Louis Philippe. He lived through the Second Republic. He lived through the Second Empire of the Emperor Napoleon III, and he died during the Third Empire. So all this took place in his one lifetime on the political scene in France. And so this is the context, and all this is all about French exceptionalism. All right. So this is what Monsieur Etienne is the context for. And this is the new Saint-Lazare. Again, it was granted to the community by Louis XVIII in 1818. And it's really from 1818 to 1864, as the Vincentians are reestablishing themselves, they are reestablishing their brand by reestablishing Vincent de Paul, by reestablishing the mother house, by reestablishing the shrine of Vincent de Paul and the relics of Vincent de Paul. On April 24, 1830, in the first public religious ceremony that has taken place in France before the revolution, the relics of Vincent de Paul are translated, or walked through, if you will, the streets of Paris, Notre Dame to the new Mother House and the new Mother House Chapel. This is a contemporary engraving of that translation of the relics on April 24th, 1830. And here's the chapel. And so again, this chapel was built in many stages from the early 1820s, essentially to the mid-1860s, when it is essentially completed. But every element of this chapel, every artistic element of this chapel, every architectural element of this chapel is part of rebranding Vincent de Paul and rebranding the Vincentian story. And as you can see, these don't really give it its due, but what you can immediately tell is, again, this is not built as a parish church, it's not built as a Vincentian church. This building is a reliquary. In the same way that Saint-Chapelle, during the medieval period, was built as a reliquary. It's a building that's a reliquary. And in the same sense, this is a building that is a reliquary. Its purpose is to be a reliquary chapel holding the relics of Vincent de Paul. And so as you enter the front doors, you see every sight line immediately draws your attention one place. And what every sight line draws your attention to is the body of Vincent de Paul. Again, there are no accidents in this building. So imagine walking up the main aisle. This is some views of the magnificence of the main altar. But again, your eyes are not drawn to the altar. Your eyes, in every instance, every element, even these ornate elements, draw your eyes beyond. And what they draw your eyes beyond to is these silver shots, the magnificent silver shots that contains the relics of Vincent de Paul. Right. Now, I have to say, I have to get on my soapbox at least once during this, that the original decoration of this was very, very carefully thought out and very, very carefully arranged. And the contemporary French have done everything in their power to ruin it. They stripped away all of it, almost all of the original decoration. They pared it down, and except for they barely preserved the sight lines. But everything that the French have done in the last X number of years, it has been to destroy the artistic and architectural authenticity of the shrine. So my soapbox, and they know that I told them that, in no uncertain terms. The latest, of course, is they've installed a sneeze guard around it. I almost had a stroke when I saw it. And so again, this is ultimately what you're drawn to see. And what we see here, of course, again, I don't have time to go into the long explanations, but what you see here, of course, under this wax effigy are the physical remains of Vincent de Paul, his skeletal remains, 76%. 24% are elsewhere. A little bit here, a little bit there, a little bit there. But the biggest majority, 76%, and they're preserved under this wax effigy in this shas. And again, all of this is meant to tell another story. And so, right, what you can see here, there's this great mural done by a Vincentian brother Francois, in 1855. And what you can barely see here is, again, Per Tranza Bene Facendo. And so the whole point of this chapel is to invite you in to contemplate Vincent de Paul as he appeared at the end of his earthly journey, as he appeared at the moment of death, as his soul, again, Vincent, his soul goes up to the apotheosis of heaven. And so again, you see another idea of how all these lines focus your attention right here. And here's another view, and this mural is just as important as every other element. And so I want to just take a few minutes to talk about it. And here's another view of it. And essentially what you have here, again, your attention is drawn up. Here's Vincent de Paul. Here's Vincent de Paul at the end of his earthly life. He now is received his reward in heaven. And from heaven, Vincent de Paul continues to look down on us here. And what we see depicted in this mural, to the right are all the works of charity done by the daughters and ladies of charity. All the works done by the Vincentians. And the whole point of this is that this is not about the past. It's not about the 19th century. It's about the present. It is an invitation for you, as a contemporary disciple of Vincent de Paul, just as Vincent de Paul went about being an apostle of charity, just as Vincent de Paul went about doing good, it is an invitation to everyone who sees this in their own lives to choose to go about doing good. Per transit bene facendo. Now, the other piece, which I didn't have, I couldn't find a photograph to quite illustrate, is, again, this whole question, from the moment you enter the chapel, you are inexorably drawn by every artistic and architectural element to the contemplation of Vincent de Paul and his values, because you can't see it, but all of these works, there are these little steps that say, here's the values that motivate these works. So here's the work, here are the values that motivate the work, here's the faith that animates the work. It worked, if you will, for Vincent and Wheezy is up here, it's kind of hidden there. And again, it's not about the past, it's not about the 19th century, it's about the present moment. So it's still brilliant, brilliant, despite what the French have done to mute it, it's still a brilliant statement. So Saint Vincent de Paul, he went about doing good and doing it well, that famous quote. He did this good and he did it well as the apostle of charity, the apostle of modern times. Again, my premise is that you and I, that's fine for modernity, but we don't no longer live in modernity. We now live in post-modernity. And so it is the task of this generation to continue to rebrand Vincent de Paul, not as the saint of modernity, but as the saint of post-modernity, the apostle of post-modernity for this world. And it's a terrible image of that three-year-old Syrian child that was drowned as an immigrant. Aleppo, starvation in Africa. So the whole point, is, again, in all of this is what's at stake for the rebranding. This is, and it is ultimately about how you and I today ask and answer the Vincentian question about what must be done. This is what ultimately what the rebranding of Vincent de Paul is about, and the rebranding of the Vincentian tradition and the postmodern world is about. What must be done today? What must I do? What must you do? What must we do to increase the measure of charity and justice in our world here and now? So the rebranding continues. Thank you.